My name is Piato. I'm from a small people group called the Moi, living in the mountain jungles of Papua. The missionaries say this is all part of Indonesia, but that's their opinion. This is our land, and has been ever since the dog that was as big as a house chased all the spirits below ground and made it possible for us to live here. When my mother gave birth to me, or as they say here in Moi land, when she cut my cord, she placed me in her string bag with some fresh leaves and carried me with her wherever she went. My dad didn't give me the name Piato until I was about a year old. In the meantime, my mother just called me Bamisi, which means a spirit is going to get you. This is understandable because most of our babies die before we even have a chance to give them a name. It was at one of these Joe dances that my relatives bought my wife for me with some shell money. She was probably about 11 years old. The problem was, she kept running away. I can't tell you how many times I had to chase her down and bring her back. I brought her home again, but nothing seemed to change. Can you believe it? She kept running away. Well, she ran away one last time. I tried to get her home quietly, but she refused. I pulled on her arm, but that didn't seem to help matters. In fact, the more I tugged, the more resistant she became. So I just shot her with my bow. I shot her 3 times, and she died. It wasn't because I didn't like her. She didn't like me. That was the only reason I had to kill her. Eventually, I married my second wife, Baigoa. And this has worked out much better. Baigoa's only run away a couple of times. In fact, it wasn't long after this that she cut the cord of my own son, Damiodi. One day when I was working in my garden, I heard the noise of a helicopter. I thought to myself, hey,
jangan takut, jangan takut. Mari, mari.
Awa.
Stephanus.
Oh.
Andy.
Andy.
Piato.
Awa.
Thank you.
None of my fears came true. They built their houses and have lived with us ever since. They wanted to know everything about our language and culture that they could. I was actually a big help in giving them language. I used to have so much fun telling them words that weren't really what they thought they were. They can be so gullible and just believe everything that you say to them.
Okay. And now?
Muffy.
Muffy.
Muffy. They were it.
Muffy.
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 They were here.
Yeah, Muffy, they were here. Oh, Movina,
they were here. So why is that so funny?
Muffy, they were here.
Well, the missionaries continued to study our language and learn our culture. All the while, the evil spirits continued to eat the Moi people. One by one, the numbers of the deceased grew. One of the people who died was my older brother. I saw his wife's lips moving one time. So I know she was the one who was working sorcery on him. A spirit did what she asked and killed my brother. At the time, I didn't do anything about it. Boy, did I live to regret that. When my brother died, I inherited her from my third wife, and she did the same thing to my family. First, I got sick. The missionary saved my life by giving me a shot. After that, my second wife and son also got sick. This, too, was the result of sorcery by my third wife. Let me tell you, when they told us the Creator's talk, I began to realize that what my ancestors had taught us and what the Moi people have believed for centuries is filled with lies.
You spread out the skies over empty space. Said, let there be light into a dark and formless world. Your light was born. You spread out your arms over empty hearts. Said, let there be light.
I guess you may already know the true creation story, but this was the first time for us Moi to hear it. Just imagine. A great big God making the heavens and earth and everything in it. He is bigger than it all, even bigger than Satan and the evil spirits that the Moi are so afraid of. I'm glad that God created the lake of fire to punish them for their rebellion against him. They deserve it. The problem is that as the teaching went on, I began to realize that I deserved to be punished too. When the missionaries would ask me what I was thinking, all I could say was, I'm scared. I'm a descendant of Adam and Eve. I'm a bad sinner, and I'm on Satan's side. And I know that when I die, I will pay for my sins in the lake of fire. Do you remember the story of Noah and how God saved him in the ark? Do you remember the story of Abraham and Isaac and how God saved Isaac by providing a perfect lamb for him? Do you remember how the Lord passed over the Israelite houses that had lamb's blood smeared on the doorposts? Well, as I sat listening to those stories, I began to realize that if God doesn't come through with His promise to rescue me by providing a Redeemer to pay for my sins, I will for sure have to pay for them myself. My nephew Kathia said it well one day after the teaching. He said, "My heart hurts. I can't work. I just want to lie down and think about this." I think we were all feeling the same way. Well, one day during the teaching, we noticed that my one-year-old son was starting to get sick. I immediately knew that my third wife was up to her tricks again. Sorcery. I tried to shoo the spirits away, but nothing seemed to help. He got sicker and sicker. His diarrhea had blood in it, and I knew that the spirits were eating him up. Not even the missionary's medicine seemed to help. Just after midnight, when Baigoa was holding our son to nurse him, his head rolled back and he died. As we wailed, I began to feel the rage building inside of me. This time, my brother's widow had gone too far. I grabbed her, dragged her out into the yard, and I did to her what should have been done long ago. I killed her. The next day, I threw her body in the river. The next few days went by in kind of a blur. We sat there, stunned and grieving. The missionaries took a break from the teaching for about a week, and they grieved with us. When the teaching began again, it was hard to concentrate after all that had happened. It felt different without my son or that woman being there, but I knew that I was still on my way to the lake of fire. I continued to listen to the teaching every day. You can imagine my surprise when I realized that the Redeemer was God Himself, Jesus. Just like the Passover lamb, He had to be perfect, and He was. I got so excited when Jesus drove the demons from people, healed the blind, even raised Lazarus from the dead. Wow, this Jesus is beyond imagination, and He's the one who's going to pay for my sins. Then, Judas betrays Jesus. The soldiers take him away. Talk about a turn of events. The next day, the missionaries did most of the teaching by acting everything out. Betrayal, whips, blood, crucifixion, and finally death. I'm no stranger to death, but, well, this was different. Sacrificing lambs was one thing, but the Lamb of God? And for me? The missionaries had a tomb set up. After Jesus died, they put him in the tomb and closed the front of it. When the angels opened the tomb, no Jesus. We were all pretty startled. We didn't know that they had a hole in the wall for him to sneak out of. About that time, Jesus came through the front door, alive. Yeah, that's the Jesus we know. After the drama, they explained to us that our sin debt was paid.
Your whispers. I'm a woman, I'm a woman. What a woman.
that simple. I want to tell you right now what I'm thinking. God, you put my sins on Jesus. When his blood was poured out and he died, he paid for my sins. Now that is straight talk. One of the first chances I had to talk with God about this, this is what I said. Thank you, Creator, for paying for my sin. Thank you that the spirits won't take me when I die. You will. You'll take me to heaven and give me a new body. Thank you, Creator. Now you may say in your language, thank you, God, for letting me be born again. But here in the Moy, this is how we say it. Thank you, Creator, that you have cut the cord of a new soul for me.
What a wonderful maker. What a wonderful savior. How majestic your whispers. How humble your love. With the strength.